some gorgeous music to share with you, and some interesting connections between these two wonderful characters, Ethel Smyth from England and Melanie Bonis from France. Now, these two were born in the same year on different sides of the English Channel, and probably weren't as well known during their lives as they should have been, and we're getting to know their music now. But so Ethel was born, you'll have to remind me, 1858, thank you. And she was a very talented young musician, and she went and studied at the Leipzig Conservatory. Only for a year, though. I think she felt that the tuition wasn't quite as good as she was hoping for, so she continued to study privately. But during that time, she got to know the likes of Tchaikovsky and Grieg and Dvorak and Brahms and Clara Schumann. So all of these names that are so familiar to us and whose style we're familiar with, these were in her musical circles. So what you'll hear today is a wonderfully rich, romantic outpouring of music from Ethel. She was a really extraordinary character. I think the other interesting thing about her life is that she was quite well known in her time as a very vigorous suffragette. Of course, you know, require, you know, looking for the women's vote and women's rights, and you know, she was really, you know, quite determined and have a very strong personality. And she even spent something like 2 months in jail because she threw stones through the window of a politician who didn't support women's rights to have the vote. So she, if she believed in something, she stood up for it. So you'll hear this kind of strong personality, I think, coming out in this music. And if I had to think of a similar composer, I would probably liken her to Brahms. I think if any of you are familiar with the Brahms cello sonatas, just kind of keep them in the back of your ear. Some things may sound a little familiar, but it's truly a unique musical voice, and one that we should all get to know some more.
Thank you.
Well,
many years ago in Ponsonby, we used to have a secondhand bookshop called Mower Hunters. And I bought this biography of Ethel Smyth in Mower Hunters. And as you do, I put it aside for years, thinking I'll get around to reading it. And then in one of the lockdowns, I was looking at YouTube and I saw, oh, somebody playing Ethel Smyth. And so I started looking at her music and found this particular sonata was on IMSLP, the International Library website. So I downloaded it and I thought, ooh. When I played it, I thought, this is quite nice. I think I will learn this. So that was how it came about.
Right.
And then I asked Sarah if she would like to play it, and she was kind enough to say yes. So it was a journey of discovery for both of us, because neither of us had played these two sonatas before.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, I think she's an extraordinary character. I mean, she was obviously living in a time where the idea of music as a career path for a woman, it was a little unusual, you know, it was certainly not encouraged, but seemingly she must have had family support if she was, you know, if she went out and studied in Leipzig, but she comes across to me as a very determined, I wouldn't say headstrong, but you know, she was a woman with purpose and a strong character, and you know, she gave up her studies in Leipzig after a year, and because she didn't think the education was good enough, and she but she carried on and you know, made friends with all these incredible composers at the time, and was probably inspired by them, you know, Tchaikovsky and Dvorak and Fanny Mendelssohn, and I don't know about Fanny Mendelssohn, but certainly Clara Schumann and Brahms. And I don't know, I find it's just, you know, it feels like she overcame a lot. And certainly as a very strong suffragette during that movement, she obviously stood up for what she believed, and I find that really inspiring. And I think, you know, we're probably still doing that a lot today, but you know, good on her for really trailblazing. And but this music is so passionate and good. It's really good music. I think that's what inspires me. It's not, there's nothing, but yeah, frilly about it. It's just, it's really gritty stuff, and you know, it's expressive.
Very, very much so. Actually, I think the her education, getting her music education, wasn't quite as easy as we might think. Her father was dead against it, but her mother was secretly for it.
I see, so it would have mixed me.
Later on in her life, she had a large family, so some of her sisters married wealthy men, and they supported her.
Uh-huh.
But the famous picture of her, which is the one on the poster, is her playing the piano and singing one of her own songs. And what she used to do when she wanted to get someone to perform an opera was she would take along the score and play the piano part and sing the principal line and all the way through the opera. And the conductor, Bruno Walter in Germany, thought she was fabulous and was trying all the time to promote her music. And various of the English conductors loved her too. But her character was at times obnoxious. She absolutely adored people, but if they got in her way and she disagreed, she said so, absolutely strongly, just like her music does.
Yeah.
Mère Bonis was, like Ethel Smyth, a devout Catholic. And this informed both their lives in a very extreme way. Ethel Smyth wrote a big mass, and she was always complaining because Elgar's music was performed so often in England, and her mass only had a couple of performances. Mère Bonis wrote a lot of religious music, and she made the wrong marriage because her parents forced her into it. And then she could never let go of the poet and singer with whom she'd been in love at the conservatorium. And so eventually, of course, they had a child together. And she went to endless bother to conceal from her husband and family that she'd been away to a sanatorium in Switzerland, not for her health, but of course to have the baby. And after that event, she devoted herself to her music and really was trying to punish herself by not having any relationships that were of any great value. The child was brought up by somebody in the country, and she saw the child very rarely. And it all is in her music, this devotion to God and torture, really, self-torture. It's very, very expressive music. It's completely unlike the Ethel Smyth music. It's just as emotional, but in a very kind of, sad kind of... And also very French music. You can hear a little bit of Fauré and Sassafrock. And she knew all these great composers. She was in the same class as Debussy was at the French Conservatoire in Paris, and they gave him the prize for composition because she couldn't get it because she was a woman. And they gave her the prize for harmony instead. So it was all a bit hard for her. And when she started devoting herself to music, she gave up wearing makeup, she gave up wearing corsets, and she gave up wearing jewellery. And it was her life, the music and trying to be a good wife at the same time. So we will play you this and see what you think of it. We've enjoyed playing it, and we think it's the first performance, apart from one we did for the university students last Tuesday.
Thank you.
The Mel Bonis sonata I heard on YouTube played by a double bass player.
Oh, goodness.
And he was doing the most magnificent things on his double bass, and I thought, whoa, well, obviously somebody should be playing it on the cello. And then I discovered by looking online that this was also available free. So I downloaded that, and then I discovered she was born in the same year as Ethel Smyth. So the obvious thing was to play them in the same concert. And then I discovered the Mel Bonis Society in France, which is run by one of her descendants. And they put out a journal at times during the year, and they advertised our concert on their website, and we were absolutely thrilled to be part of this sort of larger community of people promoting her music. Well, you might like to talk about her piano music.
Yeah. I mean, it's such beautiful writing, I think. There's nothing... I mean, it's an unusual and quite individual harmonic language, but it actually sits under the fingers really quite beautifully. You know, it's very pianistic. But, you know, I think it's... I hear snippets of, you know, Fauré and Sasson and Chausson, and, you know, even the kind of the forms that she uses, just having a theme appear in the beginning, you know, the kind of the main musical idea, and then it kind of appears later through the work, and the big sort of climax of the piece is the idea from the first movement. I love all that stuff, you know, and it's just kind of ties everything together, but it's so, again, it's this outpouring of passion and emotion, but in some ways it's a little bit more compact, you know. She's sort of to the point, and but just these really extraordinary ideas and beautiful writing, I think. Mm. But I think it seems to, I think the ensemble, the duo, is a beautiful match. I think they really, the instruments play off each other beautifully. There's no kind of dominant instrument. I think that's just beautiful, equal writing for both.
Yeah. That's true. There was, I was reading today actually about how she composed, and one of the pieces that she was writing later in her years, she was just sitting there at a table writing the music, and one of her sons-in-law came in and said, "Well, don't you need an instrument to compose?" She said, no, it's all in my head. I just, I'm composing, I can hear it.
Yeah.
So she was a true musician
yeah.
and a very fine pianist.
Mm.